So good evening, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Anju, Dr. Prashant, Dr. Bennett, Dr. Priya, and Dr. Praveen, and all the audience who have joined. And this year's theme is a wonderful theme, gut microbiome. So I will start with a short story. As usual, the organs in the body were having some dialogue with each other. And see, always, as usual, the brain said supremacy, I am the most important. Then the heart said so, the liver said so, the gut also said so. And the gut said, I am most important because I give you the nutrients. But everybody laughed. So we know gut will get upset for small things also. So gut got very angry and went into lockdown. And within a few days, the other body systems agreed that gut is the most important one. So, and regarding microbiome, we live with a lot of microbiome in our body, and wherever there is a surface contact, say skin, mucous membrane, or any one of our orifices, there is a bacterial colonization. And some people even say we are really more bug than man. Is it true? And the humans have 10 raised to 13 cells, whereas 10 raised to 14 cell bacteria are there within us. And we have less than 0.2 million years of ancestry, whereas they have 3.85 billion years of ancestry to say. They are more in number, they are seniors, they are smarter. So I have planned a 2020 innings, and so lesson one, what is the basic knowledge? That is, our pH varies from the stomach to duodenum to jejunum to colon. And based on this, the number of bacteria and the type of bacteria also varies. Mostly 80% of them are the firmicutes. That has got good and bad lactobacilli, clostridium, enterococcus. And 30% are bacteroids, and some 10% are the actinobacteria, bifidobacterium. These are very important key bacteria for us. And then the proteobacteria, that is the E. coli, and the enterobacterium. This is the non-pathogenic E. coli, not the pathogenic E. coli that we study with the diarrheal diseases. So how are these acquired? We know that when we are born with a sterile gut. And are these good or bad? So as phase one, we are sterile. Then in phase two, we acquire it from the maternal genitourinary tract and the GI tract, and from the place where the baby is born. If it is hospital, the hospital will contribute. Then in phase three, the feeding practices. If a baby is predominantly or exclusively breastfed, the bifidobacteria will be 90%, followed by lactobacilli. Whereas if a baby is bottle fed, there will be bacteroids and clostridial species coming. And once we start the semi-solids, the firmicutes and the bacteroids come. The bifidobacteria, which we attain during breastfeeding, will remain as a key flora into adulthood. That is one important message I want to convey. And the good bacteria are the lactobacilli, bifidobacteria, and the E. coli. And sometimes when a child is coming with diarrhea, it may be even a viral diarrhea, but seeing few puzzles, somebody may ask for a culture, and without typing whether it is pathogenic or not, some lab may give a report that E. coli is there, and we may shoot an antibiotic to kill them. That is very sad. These are the in major hospitals and labs, they don't give a report E. coli because it is a commensa, unless they can type it into enteropathogenic, enterotoxigenic, etc. And the bad ones are the Campylobacter, the Enterococcus, the Clostridium. And now, do we have any benefit from this symbiosis? Anyway, we are living with all these bacteria. The most important thing is that they shape and maintain our immunity, both our innate as well as adaptive immunity. We provide nutrients and shelter to them, and they in return will shape our immunity. There is a metabolic activities they do. They provide us with certain vitamins, B2, B12, vitamin K, folate, and they colonize there, and they will prevent anybody else coming and colonizing. So they are our soldiers like things. And so, but what if the symbiosis get disturbed? The term is dysbiosis. So if this is disturbed, what will happen? There will be, the barrier will be gone. We have a nice barrier of soldiers that will be gone. There will be overgrowth of pathogenic bacteria, and these pathogenic bacteria will produce a lot of bacterial products and toxins. There will be immune activation. There will be inflammatory response coming, and chronic inflammation can lead to a lot of diseases in us. And there is a leaky gut syndrome also, that hypothesis which I will describe. So the dysbiosis will lead to a variety of GI disorders and non-mucosal diseases, starting from obesity to malignancy to allergy to autoimmune diseases to autism and whatnot. So what are the factors that modify gut microbiome? As we first said, the birth mode, if it is a vaginal delivery or cesarean section, where was it done, which hospital it was done, was the baby exclusively breastfed initially, what is the diet that the baby got, what about exercise, what about diseases, what about aging also has an effect, the drugs that you take, and the geographical location where you stay, all decide our microbiome and modify it. And so how to promote healthy microbiota? As we said, the vaginal delivery, exclusive breastfeeding, etc. are most important. Then diet which contains probiotics and prebiotics. And we have to capitalize on exercise, happy aging, and avoid offending drugs. And sometimes we may have to support them with probiotics, especially in antibiotic-induced diarrhea. What happens in antibiotic-induced diarrhea? There is disturbance of gut microbiota, and the Clostridium will go to overgrowth. And to bring the balance, sometimes we may have to give some probiotics to stop the diarrhea. So what are probiotics? Probiotics are live microorganisms which, when administered in adequate amounts, confer a health benefit. It is a live microorganism. But for convenience, it is now being marketed as spore. But who will assure that the spore doesn't have any bead? Some studies have shown that some spores actually gave pseudomonas along with the lactobacilli. But it is there. So who is supposed to see that? It is the drug controller of India. We'll have to see that whatever we get is only the pure form, it is not having any weed in it. So what are prebiotics? They are substances which cannot be digested but will promote the growth of the beneficial bacteria. And symbiotics contain both prebiotic and probiotic. For example, the curd has got lactic acid bacilli as well as the probiotics. And Lilly and Stilwell in 1965 coined the term probiotic. But the concept was put forward in the turn of the 20th century, but none other than the father of modern immunology, that is Eli Metchnikoff. And he only proposed that we have microbiomes which are good for us. And what are the sources of prebiotics? The inulin type, the fructooligosaccharides, oligofructose, all are very good in the milk, breast milk and milk products. Then some of the roots, soya bean, the ginger, garlic, all we have. Pickled vegetables are good. Then we have the yogurt. And it is interesting to note that suppose a person who daily is taking curd and he takes food from outside and gets some stomach upset. And then the same curd cannot work because that is unable to fight the offending pathogen and colonize. A new strain will have to come. That is what our mothers, grandmothers were doing. They used to borrow, buy curd in between and change. That is very interesting. Then we can buy probiotics in different forms. But I said the drug controller of India is responsible to see that it is a pure live microorganism, what they claim. Or the spore is going to give only that pure culture. But this is a dietary supplement. So dietary supplements have nothing to do with the drug controller of India. If this is under FSSAI, that is the Food Safety Standards of India. And FSSAI, that is, they cannot insist on any studies. They cannot insist on any tests. And if you want to ban this, telling that this is bad, we'll have to, the complainant will have to prove in the court of law that someone died because of this food supplement. So we have to see that, are we promoting a food supplement which has no control, nobody is controlling it, or is it a drug that the drug controller of India sees that all the steps in the drug are meticulously followed? That is something which I would like you to note. And so breast milk has got lot of benefits, we already said, but another benefit is the secretory IGA, which is giving the local protection to the GIT and the respiratory tract. And secretory IGA is secreted by the gut-associated lymphoid tissue, by the enteromammary axis, and the bronchus-associated lymphoid tissue in the breast by the bronchomammary axis. And when we choose a meat item, you must choose one with least antibiotic residue, an organic product if possible. And we should not always suppress the acid and give proton pump inhibitors for a long time. Even so, the pH in the duodenum itself will go down, and most of the in the upper gut also will go down will go up. I mean, it will become alkaline, the acid will not be there, which is going to evade all the bacteria except H. pylori, which can thrive in that pH. And use of NSAIDs that can also alter the gut health. And it is said that if you give an antibiotic course, it may take 3 to 6 months for your microbiome to come back. And even if a child can tolerate a corticosteroid long term after a meal, there is a habit to prescribe a proton pump inhibitor for 3 months, 6 months, etc. That is going to be a dangerous battle. And so what is the leaky gut that we were speaking about? So when our gut is mature, the tight junctions are very strong, and there is a barrier of mycobacteria, that is the microbes which are good for us. So they will not allow any antigen or a whole protein to get absorbed. Everything will be digested into amino acids and then absorbed. Whereas in a leaky gut, for example, an immature baby, less than 6 months of old, that is, there are the tight junctions are all very loose. So any antigen or protein can go in. That is how cow's milk protein allergy, then gluten sensitivity, anything can come. And the bad bacteria, that is when all the food, that is cow's milk, animal milk, and other food are introduced early, the bacteria will change. And they will have a crosstalk with the immune system and produce lot of inflammatory response. And some people say that it may be very bad for us. So what is gut-lung axis? The gut-lung axis is that the intestinal flora has a talk with the immune system, and lung selective trafficking will go, and there is a cross protection against pneumococcal pneumonia proliferation in the respiratory tract. Similarly, there is a gut brain axis also, that is, they also have a crosstalk. And what happens is that when this crosstalk is gone, there can be chronic inflammation leading to cancer and depression, multiple sclerosis, autism, obesity, asthma, etc. So altered microbiome can lead to malabsorption, that we have studied. How? It is by bacterial overgrowth. And so there will be bacterial deconjugation coming, fat malabsorption, carbs malabsorption, protein malabsorption, and B12 malabsorption. All these can come. And similarly, inflammatory bowel disease. When your microbiome is altered, there can be a chronic inflammation going on. And if the inflammation is limited to the colon, it is ulcerative colitis. When it goes beyond the intestine, it is Crohn's disease. And colorectal cancers, when the microbiota are altered, there can be genetic, epigenetic changes happening, and there can be abnormalities in the DNA repair and signaling pathways, etc. And Lactobacillus acidophilus is said to be low risk for colorectal cancers, even when you have the genes with you. And the next is about obesity. And it is now understood that the microbiome has a say in the nutrient uptake, energy regulation, your weight and metabolic disorder. This is very interesting. See, two mice are there. One is a fat mice, the other is a lean mice. The fat mice is having more firmicutes and less bacteroids. And somebody had a fantastic idea of microbiota fecal transplantation. They took it from the donor, put it in the bad bacteria into the lean mice. And without changing any diet, the lean mice became fat. And this led to a lot of novel research. And now microbiota fecal transplant is an accepted mode of therapy. It is quite expensive. So it has come to the saying that do it yourself. There are some people who say that they take from the potty of the child and put it in their rectum and say, now I'm feeling very good. There are even studies like that, anecdotes. But this is beneficial in certain GI conditions and also some non-GI conditions like obesity, autism, etc. It is being tried. So what is done is that it is taken either as a capsule or through the nasogastric tube or as a fecal enema, it is given. 92 to 95% success is, they are claiming with this. So when you are doing this, the donor selection is very important, and we have to characterize the microbe. Are we giving the right microbe? It can be done by FISH, PCR, DNA microbe arrays, and probe hybridization are all techniques which are used to characterize the microbiota. Now, something more about the immune system. We said shaping the immune system, this microbiota has a big role. And our first line defense and second line defense are innate. That is our skin and mucous membrane, the secretions, then the killer cells, the macrophages, NK cells, and the inflammatory cytokines. And then comes the adaptive immunity, that is the T and the B cells, which give specific immunity. And this microbiota who line here as the soldiers for us, they produce certain substances which will give strength to the barrier, and it will down-regulate the inflammatory cells. Thus, it has a role in the innate immunity. And similarly, it has a crosstalk with the T cells. And you can see it has a crosstalk with the T cells, and it can lead to a lot of changes or down regulate the inflammation. And in allergy control, how does it help? 80% of our immune cells hang around in the gut. And see here, when the microbes are disturbed, our tight junctions are leaky, and the barrier is gone. So antigens can present themselves and cytokine response can happen. And an altered microbiota can also activate the T helper cells. And if the TH1 pathway gets up regulated, it will result in autoimmunity and Crohn's disease. And if the T helper 2 pathway gets upregulated, more of allergy and asthma. And they will also downregulate the T regulator cells. That is how it has a role in allergy, asthma. So lastly, in the COVID era, should we boost our immunity? And a lot of boosters are now available. You can see that at least 10 nutrients are important for our immunity, and there should not be any deficiency of this. But there should not be any excess of this also. Look at iron, for example. Iron, protein-bound iron is good for immunity, but if it is non-protein bound iron, now we have read with COVID that can cause lot of oxidative damage to the body. And in a child who is malnourished or is very young with immature immune system, etc., the non-protein bound iron can even cause more of oxidative damage and also infectious morbidity. And should we rely on nutraceuticals? And I have read in the papers that there is an increase in 400% in the sale of Chyawanprash. And then we must know how immune boosting occurs and which pathway gets boosted. And we have already studied the first line defense. So if first line defense is getting upregulated, what will happen is that there can be a lot of secretions coming. So more of coughing and secretions. And if the second line is getting upregulated, there will be a lot of inflammatory markers coming. And if the third is getting upgraded, there will be a lot of antibody production. And we don't want the aerosols. We don't want the cytokine storm. We don't want the antibody-dependent enhancement. And some of the, there can be copper, selenium, excess can cause heavy metal poisoning also. So my take is that, say yes to optimizing immunity and no to immune boosting. Remember that Amrit, the nectar of immortality, also can be a poison in abundance. So the father of medicine says all diseases begin in the gut. And he even said death sits in the bowels. A bad digestion is the root of all evil. And so the father of medicine did agree with the short story of the gut. Do we agree? And are we ready to protect the gut microbiome? Thank you very much.
Thank you, madam, for the wonderful talk. As such, as always, it was very interesting and with a lot of information. I request all of you to type down the questions in the chat box, or you can raise your hand so that we can unmute for the question answer session at the end of the CME. Now I invite Dr. Prashant K.S., pediatric gastroenterologist, Medical College Trivandrum, to talk on the topic.